Hello, everybody. My name is Ginger, and I am very excited to be with you this evening to do a live stream video to learn how to create and paint together with people all over the world. This mandala. So I've got my light on here. Maybe too bright. There. So together, there's going to be people from different places joining in and painting this, which is really exciting. And if you'd like to comment or something to me, I can see you. I have my live chat over on right here. This is my iPad because I am unable to get it all working on my computer. But if you want to comment or something like that, I'll try to look over at my iPad from time to time and see what you're saying. And that would be awesome. If you want to say where you're from, because I know there's different people around the world joining in. So I'm going to turn the camera down so you can see some tools and see some things, and we'll get started. So I have with me for this painting project our set of seven tools, Traveling Kindness Rocks set of seven tools. These are brand new tools, and I haven't marked them yet. So if you decide that you'd like to follow along with these patterns, you can go on to the website that we have and order a set. And when they come, they're like this. So I'm just going to take a second and mark on the numbers. So this one is number one. These might be upside down for you. Two. So the largest one is number one. Three. Four. Five, six, and the big one, seven. I'll go ahead and mark it on there. So those are the tools. And I'm also going to be creating my piece today on cardstock. A rock works well. And sorry, it always takes me a minute to get my camera orientated. There we go. Rock works well. A canvas works well. So this design is going to end up being about 5 inches across. And that's approximate. So that's what you'll need for space, whatever you decide to work with. And then for paints tonight, this is what you'll need for paints. Again, I'm just getting my camera. It's like it works backwards. So I've got a white. I have two greens. This one is kind of like a bright apple tart color green. This one is a pale green. And then we need three shades of purple, a really deep one. Kind of an in-between. I'm just going to call that one purple and then a light purple. So I'll call this light purple, purple, and then dark purple. So that's it for our colors. And I've marked the center of my piece, but another trick is if you've got a big piece of cardstock, you can just go ahead and paint on it and then cut around it after, which is really, you know, you just, that way you can kind of cheat and you don't have to worry about ending up even on each side, a little bit easier. So with this process, this is something I created where the tools is kind of almost like a paint by number. You get a set of our tools and then you're able to follow along with the steps and replicate your copy of the design. So these are painted in layers. The first layer is going to look approximately like this. So this is the first layer. And then we'll dry it. I have a hair dryer standing by. You should get something like that if you want to do it in time with us, or you can pause and go get something to dry it. And this is what it will look like when it has three layers complete on it. So we'll work all our way through it and pause me when you need to. And because I might be dotting at a different speed than you. So I'll talk you through the process. If you're a beginner, it will be helpful to hear how you start out one of these. And then if you're not a beginner, well, hopefully it will be a good speed for you. So welcome everybody around the world. So I've got tool number one. That's our first size we're going to work with. And if you haven't played around with the tools, this is actually the hardest one to get consistent dots with. So the bigger the tool, the more that is. So I'll talk you through some tips and things as you use it and the different times in this particular design, and then you can practice if you want to. So I'm going to find the center. I pick whichever end I'd like to, and I'm going to use white. So when you get the tool ready to take on paint, you do not do a big dunk. If you're working with kids, they're going to want to dunk on in there. What we want to do is just get just the bottom of one side dipped in the paint. And then let whatever amount of paint is there be there. Hold your paper down. If it's paper, if it's rock, you don't need to worry. And then you very gently, there's two words I like to use, gently and slowly. You just let the paint transfer until it's about the size of the end of the tool. And then you slowly lift up. And my hand has held that paper down the whole entire time, which helps. In this case, it will want to stick. It's like a suction, this big tool. So that's my center dot. And I'm going to wipe this tool clean with a paper towel and get as much of the paint off as I can. As you'll see, it will stain the tools, but they'll still work fine. So that's my center dot. So it does take some practice. If it's a little wonky, don't worry about it. I teach a lot of people, and wonky dots are still okay. I tell them you have to build far enough. It's like a tree growing. When it first starts out, you can't see its beauty. You have to wait until it grows and gets more elaborate to see all the wonderful things that's going to happen. So don't judge yourself on the very first dot. Be gentle with yourself. So we need tool 6. And we're going to create our first set of dots that this is going to build out in sets of 8 dots tonight. And we're going to use our light green for this first set. So I've got tool 6 and I have my light green. And what I'm going to do is dip that in. And I'm thinking of this as a clock. And where my 12 o'clock spot would be, I'm going to put one of my first set of 8s. It's hard to see the color, but that is light green. And then I'm going to get more paint. So if you're working with kids, kids can do this, by the way, but they'll need a couple steps of encouragement. As one is, a younger kids will want to skip putting paint on every single time. If you can get them doing that, that will be the biggest thing you can do to help them achieve a nicer piece. So go straight down to where 6 o'clock is. So we're going to continue to play with 12 o'clock, 6 o'clock. Now you rotate your paper. And what we do is we just do that same action again. So we're going to divide this distance in half. And we're doing 12 o'clock, more paint, and then 6 o'clock. Okay, so we've got our first 4 dots. They should be about the same size. And you can see I'm aiming for them to almost touch my middle dot. If they touch, that's okay. If they're a little bit farther away than you'd like, that's okay. That will come with practice. Now turn your paper again. So it's like an X. I had one little guy I was working with this week say, "Hey, Ginger, that looks like an X." I said, "You know what? I'm going to steal that. I love that. Helps me to describe it to people." Now I'm going to divide my distance in half again, and I'm doing the same action. It becomes easier for us if we're actually doing the same action over and over again, 12 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and we don't have to adjust our vision. So there we go. We've got our 2 more dots, and we're aiming for 8. So we turn our paper one more time. 12 o'clock, 6 o'clock. So all of my patterns so far are based on an 8-point mandala. They are the ones I've been teaching in a workshop. Eventually, I'll expand and get some other ones happening. But for right now, this is working. We've got lots of patterns to choose from. Until we build a community of people where they're comfortable and ready to start some other things, and they get more time, because everything's keeping me really nice and busy, then we'll keep to the 8 dots. Now, we need, hello everybody. I'm just seeing where everybody's from. I love seeing this. It looks like the tool doesn't really connect to the canvas. Yes, Laura, that's a great way, especially the bigger the tool. This, if you were to be able to slice through there and see what's happening, the tool, like see through. So thanks for asking about that. Hi everybody, we got someone from South Africa watching. It's so wonderful to get to connect with people that I've been emailing and get a chance for you to all to meet, because I've been connecting with you, each of you. So this is fantastic. So we need tool 4 now. So this is tool 4, and we're going to work with our apple tart green. So you always need to know what color, what tool, and then where to put your dots. So now that we've done our first set of 8, it becomes actually a little bit less directive from me as we make our next sets. But I'm going to do these on an imaginary line so you can kind of see how they're built. So this is like an imaginary line that's going from here to here, and you're going to put some apple tart green tool size 4 dots on each of those. So I'm going to go ahead and make those, and I like to work from, it will look to you like I'm at the 12 o'clock spot, but the camera's reversing everything. So I actually work down from the bottom of my paper and rotate my paper each time. So I'm really not doing anything different. I'm doing the same action over and over again, which makes me build consistency. I'm not adjusting where, which angle I'm working from. I'm doing the same thing. I'm repeating, getting the same amount of paint each time. And so as I've practiced, I've become more consistent because of that. So keep rotating your paper and work from the spot that works for you. So there's our next set of 8 dots, and it's building beautifully. Now we need tool 6 again. And I'm looking at my step-by-step directions. So if you want a copy of this, it is available on the website at travellingkindnessrocks.ca. So we're going to work with white and tool 6. And so let me just show you where the dots go. Okay. Yes, Laura, I said that the tool does not make contact with the paper or your rock or your canvas, whatever you're painting on, especially the bigger tools, the more that is the case. She was just asking me to clarify that. So this is tool 6, and this is white, and it is in line with our first set of green dots. So you always have to be clear on where the dots go. So when I get teaching big groups, and every once in a while I have someone who ends up getting their dots happening in a different location, and they just kind of end up on a different pathway, and we make it work. But if you can, and we're all working to create the same thing around the world, follow and check out carefully where the dots are going and what size tool. The color's really easy to change. So if you happen to pick up the wrong color, but you got it in the right spot and you got the right tool, that's easy. You just got to let it dry and you go back over it with the right color. So that would be, you're welcome, Laura. That would be the best way to do it. So really easy to change the color. All right. I'm just checking to see if anything else here. Hi, everybody. Let's see. Where are we? We need tool 5. And we're going to now get some purples happening. We haven't had a whole lot of purple going on. So I'm just going to remind you that looks really dark on my screen. That is just dark purple. And this is, I'm going to call it purple. It's the medium shade. And then we have our light purple. So we're going to work with light purple. And we have tool 5. And so as we build outwards, this is where I'm going to really take the time to imagine that there is a dot right here in the center of my design. And I line up with that imaginary dot. Now, when I first started doing this, you would see me like this. I'd move that tool, and I'll just do it here so you can see. So I would literally line it up and get things in place. And I still do that if I'm doing a really big piece. Even if something gets a little crooked when you were doing your last step, don't line it up with the crookedness. Line it up with that center dot. That's the rule of thumb. Now, if I was with you and I was looking at your piece, there may be kind of times where we would choose the middle ground and we'd kind of try to tweak it a bit to be kind of in between those two issues. But if you can, as you go, just line it up with that imaginary dot in the very center. Get more paint every time. Hello from Houston. Thank you, David. Thank you for your nice words. It has been so fun. I have been very, very busy seeing people in workshops over the last 7 days. In the last 7 days, I've seen 400 people in person and teaching them from ages 5 up to Well, I did a group of adults, so I don't know. There was this one lady that was a senior in that group. So it has been a real whirlwind of people, and you folks are like at the end of that stream of people. I get a little break tomorrow, and then I'm off to Moncton on Saturday. So if any folks know someone in Moncton that might want to learn how to dot, you can let them know I'm going there on Saturday morning. So now we're going to cover a lot of territory. It's been pretty small, detailed work so far, and we're going to really cover some surface here. We need tool number one again. I'm just going to see, Miss Laura has another question. Show the tool number when I'm using it. Oh, sorry, Laura, that's a great idea. So we're going to use tool one, and we're going to work with our purple. So that's the middle shade. And I'm just going to switch my paint so I'm not dripping it across. So I'm going to get paint on my tool every single time. And I'm in line once again with my white and my purple, lighter purple that I just did. So nice, big, beautiful dots. Now, as I watch people, and I've taught lots of people, one thing I have started to notice and therefore encourage is that adults especially are worried about the amount of paint they get on this tool. And notice, by the way, before I say too much, my hand, my other hand, is always holding this down. So if you've got something light, like a piece of paper, hold it down. Okay, I'm going to keep turning it. So the adults will stress a bit about the amount of paint. Let the amount of paint be on there. You need that paint to get that nice shaped dot. And as you put it on your surface, let the paint spread out till it is at least the size of the bottom of your tool. Nice big dots. Let them be big and beautiful, taking up the room. Because when I create the patterns, that's what it's based on, is it being that full size. Now, it can still work fine. But from what I've seen, when we get to the next layers, it is definitely helpful if you've made these dots their full intentional size. And again, that will come with practice. Nice big purple dots. So yes, I've been working with primaries. I would see them for about 45 minutes. I didn't teach them a pattern. I just taught them how to do the starting point. And with by the time they're in grade one, the grade primaries, I'm going to tell you, you put tools and paint in front of them, they were having a rough time just sticking to a pattern of eight. Their patterns more had about 30 or 12. They just were dotting like crazy. It was awesome. But by the time they're in grade one, they could control themselves enough to get an 8-point design. It was awesome. And then I've worked with kids in classes, full classes, as young as grade two this week, where they were doing copies of these patterns. So it was so awesome. Now, where are we in the design? We need tool four again. I'll tell you about another group that I saw, which was really great. So it's tool four, and we are working with the lighter green. And we're going to put this, again, we're working out on our imaginary line like that. So it's really foundational. You can actually see, if this was a house, this is like the important structure here. And I don't know enough about carpentry to make the analogy any more specific than that. But, you know, this would be like your foundation. So there are dots that are more of a foundation in designs than other ones, and we are creating them. So this is going to bring the design out as far as it's going to go. And if you've been worried about if you're going to fit everything on whatever surface you're working on, this dot is the outer extremities of the design. So yeah, I was working with a group I've been in a number of counties here in Nova Scotia this week alone, working in schools, and it was so wonderful to be part of a wellness, mental wellness day for a high school. So the high school actually included junior high. They call themselves a high school, but it was grades 7 through to 12. And the students, they whizzed in and out of the room with me. They had 45 minutes, and I got them sitting down, and they came in, and they were just so fantastic listeners. And within 45 minutes, they were creating their own mandalas. It was wonderful. I've got something going on here where you can't see it. So you can tell this has really built the foundation. Now what we're going to be doing is we're actually started to do the start of an outline here. So when you ever want to outline a larger dot with some smaller dots, it's really important that if you're creating your own design, you need something like this. I call it the anchor dot sometimes. Sometimes with kids, I call it the middle dot, but you have to have that so that each side can become symmetrical. So you have to have something just to anchor it, to put it in into those two divisions of sides. So we're going to go around those sides now. You need tool 6, and we are going to put a dot on either side. When I'm working with kids, I like to call them the neighbors, the friendly little neighbors. We're working with the brighter green now, and we're going to get, if it's possible to have a corner, we're going to nestle them in close in there, as close as we can. If it's possible for dots and circular things to have corners, that's where they go. By the way, if you're new to this, you're like, how long is this woman going to be yakking before we get to the second layer? The first layer is like 70 to 80% of the work and the time. And I like to say about 70 or 80% of the magic happens on the top layers. It's just, it's amazing to me that it can start to look so cool so quickly when we get to that. There we go. We're getting those neighbors on there. It's so great to see you all talking and communicating. I want to tell you, if you want to see another video, and do some more dotting, and I have to say a public thank you to this person, and I apologize if I say her last name wrong, but her first name is Kristen, and her last name is spelled U-H-R-I-G, and she has a YouTube channel with lots of followers, and out of the kindness of her heart, she produces videos where you can learn how to create dot mandalas with her. And she does a fantastic job of editing them and making them sound and look beautiful and relaxing. They're so wonderful. And I want to say a public thank you. By the way, I'm getting tool 7 ready to go here. I want to say a public thank you to her because she has been creating videos using different types of our tools. And that, I'll just get you going here and I'll tell you a little bit more. So we're going to use tool 7. And I'm going to be going around here. Now, depending on how much paint you put on here, in the instructions, my suggestion is that you dip once into your paint, get reloaded in paint. I just dipped once more time, one more time, and then follow your shape around. Now, that works for me. You may find that you don't need to dip. You just need, or re-dip. You might just be able to go once and then go around. It depends on how big your purple dot was and how much paint you've put on this tool 7. So I'm going to do this part and always reapply and start your process again up here at the top. So I'm going to do once into my paint, one more time into my paint, and then taper. I call this the taper around here. So yes, Kristen's YouTube channel, she has nearly 10,000 followers. And one of our very first sets of tools was purchased by her. And she and I have connected because of that and because she has very kindly promoted them on her videos, which has just been amazing. And I bet you some of you folks watching have actually made your way to Traveling Kindness Rocks because of her. So Sue Wilbur is asking in Nova Scotia what colors these are. Sue, this is the lightest green here in the middle. This on each side is my apple tart, and this color, I apologize if I didn't say it, folks, this is white that I've been using here. Okay, so this is white that we're using to outline. So yes, I wanted to just say thank you to Kristen, and also I wanted to encourage you, if you are enjoying learning through videos, to please check her videos out, because she does a fantastic job of creating a piece and then talking you through it in a wonderfully edited video that she makes just out of the kindness of her heart, which is just amazing. So shout out to Kristen. down in the USA. So here I go around here. You're welcome, Sue. Shout out to you over there, Mount Uniac. If you enjoy doing these patterns and you would like to do more of them, I welcome you to check out what I'm currently calling the Pattern Club, although it really does not encompass what it's all about. It really needs a new title and I've been thinking on it. But basically, it is a group of people around the world who subscribe and to getting a pattern a month that is created to represent a charity from somewhere in the world. And then our membership fees, part of them is donated. I have a record keeping system and keep track of it all and then donate a portion of that to the charity. So I'm about to reveal May's pattern for the month. It's coming up. So in order to participate, you'd need a set of these tools and you'd get emailed to you instructions and you're welcome to post photos of your pieces from around the world. And I just realized I slid that on you. Sorry. So if you feel to check that out, that would be wonderful. We'd love to have you join in with us. Now, from watching people in my classes, I know that yours may not look exactly this shape. So I'm going to give you some tips. As it builds out, you get to kind of play around with the instructions. So in the instructions, I would use, this is tool number two, and I would put it in here. So what you can do is you can actually take a minute and you can say, hey, is that going to fill in my spaces today? And even mine, I may need to switch. So if there is a large space and your piece grew and it has bigger spaces, feel free to switch and go to the larger tool and just check that that's going to work for you. Or you may even need to shrink down and use a three if yours is a little bit tighter knit than someone else's. That's no problem. You may even find that one side needs a two and another spot needs a one. And nobody's going to necessarily know the difference. Your biggest goal is to do what I'm going to do here. I'm going to take white and I want to fill in the space. So whatever it takes for you to fill in that space, that's what you want. So don't sacrifice that just to say, hey, you know what? I still use the same size tool, but look at that big space. So like I can do this one here. You can see that's leaving some gaps. So I got a couple choices. I could have done that with a one. My other trick is I can take number two and get more paint and go right over it. And it becomes a size kind of like in between one and two. So I just kind of made it a little bit bigger there. I want to fill in that space. And basically where they're going is, if you can see, it's like an imaginary circle that's going around there. And these are going along that imaginary circle line. So you want to get them nice and filled in there. And if you have any other questions about things as we're creating them, or if I missed a question, because my feed that I'm looking at over at my screen on my iPad, it's just kind of scrolling and I don't have time to kind of go and scroll it up. So if I've missed a question, just state it again, feel free. And I'll keep trying to peek up at my iPad and catch them. Oh, there we go. See, the screen gets backwards on me. That's looking good. And we need just a couple more steps. So we need tool five, and we're going to start to fill in these zones here. And again, you can take your dry tool and just see, is that going to fit in there, and modify as you need to. So as you get building out, don't be afraid to modify something. My tool five looks like it's going to work. I'm going to use light purple. I'm going to put a dot in here. So if yours is too squishy, go to a smaller tool. If yours spot is a little, I'm going to be very gentle as I do this one. Very barely touch it. And I can sneak it in there because I've got pretty good control over it. But you can see that one's a little bit smaller than these ones. So if you have trouble controlling the tool, switch the tool. And that one might get a little tiny bit bigger just to fill it in. There we go. This is a great introductory pattern. When I design them, I put my teacher hat on. So for those of you folks that don't know me, I'm actually not an artist, and I have shied away from that label anytime anybody's wanted to apply it to my likeness. I tend to say, well, I'm comfortable with the term daughter, D-O-T-T-E-R. That works okay for me because I can do this, but I am not a trained artist. This work started in my classroom, my grade 5 and 6 classroom. So I think it's awesome that I'm getting to teach people from so many places, and I'm very humbled to say that, because that's what I am. I'm comfortable with that name and label, teacher. Teacher. Okay, so we need tool 7, same color. And now we're gonna take some care. I haven't encouraged lining up with the middle. I want you to line up with the middle again and put your little dot that you're gonna put in line with the middle. So it looks like it's just shoved on in there, really, when you might be thinking, but I'm taking my time and I want it to line up with my middle. All those little things, it's about drawing the eye into the center. So anytime you can line something up with the middle, because we're kind of back to a foundational dot here, do it. We want it lined up with the middle. That's what a mandala is all about, is lining it up, drawing the eye into the center. So this is going to complete our bottom layer. Yay! We've got 35 folks around the world doing this. This is fantastic. So I'm going to put it back on me. Here I am. So you remember what I look like, and I'm going to get my hair dryer and I'm going to dry it. And like I tell kids, this is going to be dry-ish. Dry-ish means I can put more dots on top of it, but I can't poke my finger in it. So when you're working with 6-7 year olds, that's an important thing for them to understand. It's going to be dry-ish. Here I go. All right, that is dry-ish for sure. So dry-ish means, turn my bright camera, my bright light up. If you can see, you can kind of see the dampness there. Now, if I had tons of time, I'd let that thoroughly dry and I wouldn't even use my hair dryer. My hair dryer can do kind of wonky things to my paint. So I'd prefer to let it air dry whenever I have time. It works a little bit better. But hey, we're together, so I'm going to do it, and I don't mind sacrificing anything for doing this with you folks. So let's put it back down here, get my camera figured out. It's like new day all over again, 51st states when I try to deal with this camera and figure it out. There we go, almost. Aha. So now we're going to put on our second layer of dots. So we're going to work from the middle outwards again. I'm going to be very gentle, and if you haven't drawn yours past this point, I would draw yours a little bit more. I have pretty good control over how hard I push down on my dots, and I'm feeling like I can get them in there and not mess up my paint. But if yours is too wet for you to work with, stop the video and dry it, because all you're going to do is end up getting wet paint merging with wet paint, and you want crisp, distinct lines between your layers of color. This is what we're going for, let's remember. So in order to do that, you have to have dry enough paint. So we're going to work from the middle out, and it's tool 3. And my center is going to be that dark purple. Now you notice I didn't put any dark purple on the first layer. That's for a reason. When I first started working with dark purple, I discovered something. If I put it on the first layer, all it does is dry and it looks like it disappears. It looks black. So this dark purple in this particular paint has to be on the second or third layer. So I'm just looking. That might have not been my best dot in the whole wide world because my paint's a little bit wet, but that's not too bad. So I'm going to leave it. So getting that in the very middle is hard. That is one of the hardest things. So if you wanted to practice just even doing that, like getting the center dead on, you could, you know, get out some paper one day and make some dots and then try them as if they're the center, because that's probably one of the hardest things. If you didn't like it, you could actually reapply your paint. If you kind of got it a little off center and you could readjust. So I'm going to do that. And I just kind of readjusted it and made it a little bit more so that it was, had even white part all the way around. That's a good way to describe it. Okay. Tool seven, we're going to keep building out. So we're going on to these, and what we're going to do is put our apple tart color, a brighter green, on top of that. So I just get a little bit on my tip of my tool and away I go. A little bit on each one. So yeah, it really is an awesome experience to get people from different places all over the world emailing me. And one of my visions for Traveling Kindness Rocks is that it will connect people. And that's why I'm doing these live video classes, is I want people to, I want people to be able to connect with each other and not just with me. So total numbers for the first five rows. My sound has cleared up. I'm not sure what you mean, Laura. Not total numbers, tool numbers. Oh, this was 6, 4, 6, 5, 1, 4, 6, 2, 5, and 7. I remembered them all. So Laura was just getting herself caught up there. Now back to tool seven, and what we're going to do is put a dark purple on top of the lime green color there, that apple tart green. So just very gentle, and I'm aiming for it to be, again, lined up, which actually happens to also hopefully be the center of my green. I'm just lining it up there. So yes, I get emails and I'm spending lots of time getting back to folks, and I apologize if I don't ever get right back to you. It's probably because I'm having a string of days like I have lately where I'm out and about and doing workshops. So right now the enterprise of Traveling Kindness Rocks consists of myself doing workshops. I run the website. I do all the social media. I pack things up to mail them. I email people, and so I'm doing all that stuff. My life partner, Steve, he makes the tools. We have got to the point where we're getting people to help make the tools as well, so that's awesome. And then I have my mom, who tracks the fundraisers amount, and she does write out the messages in the Traveling Kindness Rocks letters that are, she's the only person other than me that sees the requests for Traveling Kindness Rocks. I trust my mom. So those are the people involved behind the scenes right now. Now, where are we? We're on our white, and we're going to use tool seven again, and we're going to put light purple on there. So this is tool seven, and it's light purple going on there. So I've had an idea for these live classes. I'm going to continue to offer them. I have one coming up in May. I'll tell you about it at the end. And people in Nova Scotia, you might be able to help me with this. I think it'd be really cool to have guest daughters. I think that would be a great idea, to have people either learning or people who, you know, have done it before but would like to come and be guest daughters. I keep putting number seven down and I keep needing it. Number seven again, if we're going to use white. Yeah, so if you don't know what Traveling Kindness Rocks is, really quickly, it all started a year ago right now. I was teaching full-time in my grade 5 and 6 classroom. So I have been teaching full-time up until June that just passed. And then I took a year's leave of absence from my teaching position. But a Traveling Kindness Rock grew out of work in my classroom. That's where I learned how to do this technique and developed all my ideas around the tools, the patterns, the process. And then I started giving the rocks away, and the students and the staff and families of my school helped me to send them around the world to people I didn't even know. And that was where the whole concept of Traveling Kindness Rocks began. Tool two. So we're going to work on top of this purple. Now, in my workshops with tool two, some people make this dot, the first dot, so, not so small, but smaller than mine. So I suggest to them that they use tool three. So you can take a minute and just think about which one you want to still see a ring of the bottom layer. That's important. So if you need to switch from tool two, or you have trouble still controlling tool two, go for tool three, and you can even reapply the paint and put more paint on tool three and make it twice. You might have better control over that than tool two. I'm going to use tool two because it works for me, and I'm using my dark purple, and it's going to go on each of these. And again, I would suggest you hold down your paper if you're working on paper, because it will want to stick to the tool. The bigger tools will want to do that. Now, you can tell that this is not dry. This is less than dry-ish. And it's good to see that, because that's just proving that you need it to be dry. And that's why I'm getting some wonky dots there. I didn't use my hair dryer far enough. That one's a little bit better. But that's the reason why. If you're getting weird shaped dots, it'll be a few issues that you can start to play around with and see what's happening for you. One is, it's not dry enough. If you go onto your top layer and you get something like this happening, these ones here, which way are we going to move this so you can see it like that? It's because that's not dry. The other thing that could be happening is that your paint, if you've had it out for a while, is changing its consistency. It's drying out. If your paint is dry, you're not going to get yourself a wonderful dot. Hello from the United Kingdom. So awesome. I'm so excited. I was so excited to do this tonight. So awesome. Yeah, it could be that. And the other thing could just be that you're not going straight down and just don't have yet quite the right pressure. So it's probably one of those three things. So if you were getting consistent dots and then something like this fella shows up, it's probably the wet paint or too thick of paint because they've dried out and changed their consistency on you. Now, let's see. Where are we? Three, tool three. And we just need that tool, and we're going to go onto our white. And again, you know what? I'm going to take a minute. I'm going to learn from my mistakes. I'm going to hair dry. Those white dots are not dry enough. All right, that's way better. They're going to work for me now. So I dried my white dots enough. They're dry-ish. That means I can paint on them, but I can't touch them. So I've got tool three in my hand. I'm working with light purple, and I'm going to go right onto here. So if you changed and modified this size of this, oh my goodness, that one did it too. I'm going to reapply that. If you changed and modified that size of that tool, it did it again. Then if you used a larger tool or smaller tool, adjust this down. I'm going to dry this again because I can see this one's still wet. I thought when I was looking at it that it was dry. It's not. Well, hello there from Minnesota. I see Minnesota's joined us. Sorry that the time zone thing, that that it was different than what you were thinking. I am in Nova Scotia, so I will be posting with Atlantic Canada times. And by gosh, if I knew all the time zones, I'd gladly help you convert it, but I will have to leave the conversion of time zones to you folks as you get ready for upcoming classes, because I will do this again. Oh, look, finally, that one worked really well. Usually I have much better luck, but usually I have more time to let these dry. So yeah, I was saying adjust your tool size. If you did not use tool two in one of these zones, you went up a size or down a size, adjust your second layer dots as well. Because I think the ratio of the light purple to the white is what you'd be going for there, like that ratio. So we're getting close to this layer being done. Oh, we are done that layer. We just have one more dot to do on the third layer. So I'm gonna draw it up again because the dot's going to go on here on these zones that I just did. So here I go. I'll put the camera up again because you probably want to see me drawing this, I'm assuming. Oh no, I missed stuff. Hold on, people. Hold on. Back down you go, camera. I did miss some things. I missed these in here. All right, we got to get those going. We need six, tool six. So we're going to do some layering on here. So right in here, we're going to put our apple tart green. Oh, that's going to be it. Really pop. There. That's much better. And those are easily dried. Those are tiny dots. Hello from Spain. I'm so happy you're here. Oh, my goodness. I'd love to know how many countries we've got doing this. So here's the thing, folks. I think it would be awesome if you would like to. I completely welcome you. And, like, I get super, uber excited. Like, totally excited when I see pictures of these come to social media. It is just such a treat to see them around the world and the same pattern showing up. Like, oh my gosh, I get so excited. So if you would like to, hello from Georgia. Take your copy of this. And by the way, I haven't preached to you yet, to folks. By the way, I'll say it while we do this. This is tool seven. And I'm using the lightest green and just going to put one of those on each of those. So here's the thing. These are like a song. I'm a musician. I am a trained musician, not a trained artist, trained musician. These are like songs. So every single time I paint this, just like if I was to sing a song, I am able to make it look like my other ones because it's the one that I did. It's my voice doing this version of this composition. But when you do it, you may make your dots slightly bigger, slightly smaller. You may make them farther apart. You may make them closer together than me. And that adds up to all kinds of small differences. So if we were to see these beside each other, we'd know that they are copies or replicas or versions of the same thing. But it's your version, which is awesome. So just be aware that there will be differences, and that's wonderful. I've missed one other thing, people. We need on this one, let me just see, some purple. That medium shade of purple is going to go on here. Yeah, so if you would like to take your copy of this out and about in your neck of the woods, wherever that is. So I'm not talking about by your Chesterfield, because I can't tell where your sofa is. I get all excited about it if I see like a landmark or a road sign or a flag or something like that. Hey, you could even go and get your prime minister or president if you want and get them to take a picture with your mandala to show where you are. So if you want to do that with this one and post it to Traveling Kindness Rocks to show that you're part of this class, that would be awesome because I get so excited about it. So let's blow dry this. All right, I had a question about things getting completely centered. So I'm gonna answer that real quick. Here's my suggestion. This is a great example. So this is on a complete piece of cardstock. I don't know if you can see it. So I don't even worry about it if I do it on a piece of cardstock, because I can do the whole thing and then I can play around with like a ruler and I can cut it to something symmetrical. So if I just go ahead and slap it on there, the center is the center that I created. I don't have to worry about it. So that is one tip if you're working on cardstock. It is tricky to do if you are working on a canvas or a rock per se. That is something that will come with time and practice. And if you've got like, you know, an expensive material, like a really expensive canvas, you might want to just cut cardstock like I have here and practice with the cardstock, getting that centered before you use canvas. But it just does come with practice. And if you're using a canvas and you put it right on this, you try to get the center and it's off, like I did a pretty good job with this one, then the rest of it, it's hard for it, that to compensate. So practice on something first, just getting it on something cheap, like a piece of cardstock, and it will come with time. It's like anything, you just have to practice. Debbie, I don't know if I've sent your tools yet. If you want to email me, I will be glad to check on it for you. All I know is if you ordered it since this afternoon, the answer is no. If you've ordered it before then, the answer is yes. But because I've been to the post office, and you should receive a notification from the website. Once I get home from the post office, I put in the notifications and it should email you. But if you aren't sure, shout me out an email and I'll gladly look into it once more for you. So our last dot, and again, this is a little bit wet, but I have come to be able to do this pretty well. I'm gonna say that and then I hope I don't mess myself up. I can just gently drop that on there. Aha. I've learned, this took like thousands of these to learn, I can do this very gently with just tool 7. That is pretty wet paint, but when it's wet and I'm working with tool 7, I've learned to very gently like drop it into wet paint and wet paint, and it will make it that size. That has come with practice. If that doesn't work for you, dry it all the way and then put your dot on. So if you have any other questions, let me know by email. But what I'll do is I'm going to set up a Facebook event, and information's already on the website with another live class that I have planned, which is in May. So I've just got my date down here. So it's Thursday, May 25th. It's a different pattern, a different design. This is my copy that I did this evening that's still wet, with a little smudge. I love that little smudge, so because I get people freaking out in workshops, and they're like, ah! I'm like, no, 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 it's okay. So all I need to do is get some black paint on the tip of this, and I will put it over there. It's like a magic marker, and it like goes away. So there's very little things that we can't fix. So I love my smudge, because it shows that I make smudges too, like all the time, and I will just get rid of it later. If you want to sign your piece, by the way, Sharpies are awesome. So this is the first one when I created the pattern. This is tonight's replica, all right? So thank you so much for joining in. And if you would like to, it would mean so much to me if you'd like to take your copy of your purple and green mandala out and about in your neck of the woods, wherever you happen to be in the world, and take a picture and share it with all of us on social media for Traveling Kindness Rocks, which is Facebook is Traveling Kindness Rocks, 2 L's. And then Instagram account is Traveling Canadian and Kindness Rocks, and again with the 2 L's. So you can post your picture of your design and share with us and get familiar with the community of people around the world who are starting to connect together, which is awesome. Good night, everybody. Blessings to you from Canada.